presentation will be by Mr. Stefan Muller and Ms. Lalit Edirisinghe. This is on converting Sri Lanka into commercial hub in Asia, an assessment of post-war progress with insights to the way forward. The second presentation is by Mr. MBBC Pereira, SPP Amaratunga and HK Amarasinghe. This is on general assessment of knowledge economy orientation of Sri Lanka. The third presentation is by IDRR Palliarachi. This is on sustainability of promoting upscale tourism in Sri Lanka, in Sri Lankan perspective. The next one is by Mr. U.G. Rajapaksha and W.M. Semasinghe and D.A.C. De Silva, Impact of Education and Rural Poverty, a Literature Review. Also, we have a presentation by K.K. Pradeep Ranavira on needs of redefining sustainable development policies, practices and consequences in Sri Lanka, focusing to the on to be a hub in Asia. The last presentation of the day would be from EGDC Bandara, UK Jayasingha Mudalige, JMM Udugama, AMCM Attanayaka and JC Edirisinghe. This is on food agricultural sector, whether it's played its intended role in socio-economic development of Sri Lanka. So I'm sure these are of very importance, timely, and they are of very high importance for the current demands, current paradigm of the Sri Lankan economic development process. Ladies and gentlemen, before we start, let me mention that we are somewhere about 45 minutes almost late behind the schedule. So I invite all the speakers to be punctual and also on time, and don't exceed your time limit that is given to you. 10 minutes is given to you, and by 8 minutes you will be notified with a red light, and then at the conclusion of the 10 minutes there will be a red light, sorry, green light, the bell is rung, and you better stop at that time, otherwise I will stop you. So I hope that we all will agree to that order of the day and rule of the game. And what do we do for the questioning session? Can we stick to 5 minutes questioning session? Do we want to have it at the end or just after each paper? Maybe after each paper 5 minutes? Okay, so please stick to 5 minutes and don't exceed there also. Right. So with that agreement, may I first invite the first presenter of the day, Mr. Stefan Muller, with the support of Mr. Lalit Edirisinghe. This is on converting Sri Lanka into a commercial hub in Asia. The podium is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Gunaruan. So, as you can see, we are trying something new here. Using technology, we want to capitalize on the best available opportunity to try to do what we can from far here in Australia. Now, to start with, as you can see, Mr. Lalit Edirisinghe, my co-researcher and I, we ventured into this research, basically looking at the development agenda that the government of Sri Lanka has. Starting from 2005, the main focus has been converting Sri Lanka into a naval, aviation, education, commercial and energy hub. Now, there are very visible development results that we see, especially in the infrastructure aspect. But then as practitioners, academics and researchers, Lalit and I, we also had this intention to see, especially the post-war progress the country has been making at a global scale. So that's why we ventured into this research. It's a great opportunity that the Sir General Sir John Kottalawal University has given us, and we thank the organizers for giving us this opportunity. And we'll try our best. We have tried our best to be as objective as possible in this research, because we feel that the country needs to be focused in the right perspective in the global arena. Now, to start with, these are the research objectives that we set for ourselves. As you can see, our basic research was focused on making this objective assessment to see how Sri Lanka has progressed, specifically in the post-war few years. When you look at the development agenda, as I said, of the five key hubs, three of these are directly related to international trade, cross-border movement of cargo, and even people. The naval hub concept, commercial hub, and the aviation hub. So we thought that it's quite appropriate to look at indices, indexes, and ranks or scores that are out there in the global arena and see what assessment we can derive or what impression we can derive on the progress of the country. So that was our first research objective. Then we thought that we can compare the 3-4 years of post-war era with the previous pre-war situation and see what the progress is, so that we can derive this objective assessment. And finally, to identify if there are any impediments for further progress as to what can be done and make some recommendations. Now, the key focus we would like in these 10 minutes is to give you some thoughts on these global indicators that we have found and the progress made. As you can see on the screen, these are some out of many that we found out, analyzed, and assessed. These are some key indicators that really reflect, depict, and illustrate what's going on out there. Now, these are indicators not designed by any political party or any Western group or any interest group. They are global indicators developed by agencies like the World Bank, the International Finance Corporation, which is also a part of the World Bank, the Global Economic Forum, or the World Economic Forum, the United Nations Development Program. Now, as you can see, some of these indicators show a very impressive progress of the country. If you look at the Global Competitive Index, the GCI, which is a very important index in the current global economic and international trade arena. As of 2009, just before the war ended, Sri Lanka was ranked 77 out of 134 countries, with a score of 4.02. But as of 2003, this has increased. The rank has increased, most importantly, and Sri Lanka is now number 52 out of 152 economies. A very clear indicator that something is happening. Now, this global competitiveness index has many elements in it, and this is a collective indicator that there is a lot of progress happening. When you look at the next, which is directly trading across borders, Sri Lanka was a little bit, you know, just below the three-digit rank, 99 out of 185 in 2009. In fact, in 2007, it was worse, but we only look, it is in our research paper when you, if you get a chance to read it. And there is a significant increase. The country has now moved up to the 56th position out of 185 economies. Likewise, you can see the other indicators how Sri Lanka has improved. The logistics performance index, which takes into account and which is directly again related to cross-border movement of trade, especially in the backdrop of the harbor, Colombo Port, is a critical element that, or critical factor that we, the country can look at. Because again, LPI, we have 137 out of 155, very dismal. That was in 2010, because the this is a report called the Connecting to Compete report. This is the second report that was published in 2010, a score of 2.29. Whereas, as of 2013, the same report, we have in the country, Sri Lanka has moved up to the 81st out of 155 countries. A good progress. There are the other indicators or the indices that you can see. I'm not going to take you through all that in this short time. But the last one from the UNDP is a very general indicator, but quite satisfactory, because UNDP has clearly, we quoted directly from the UNDP report, which sees Sri Lanka as an early achiever on 10 out of the 21 indicators that the UNDP has used in its Millennium Development Goals. So these are the key findings that we saw, right? I told you about the research objectives we set for ourselves, and we went into these the research, and these are the key findings. There are much more, right? A bit more in the research paper. From there, what we did was, we looked at the way forward. And we see that if the country is to move forward, there are five key areas that much more work has to be done. Regulations and legal area, where there are about 80 legislations related to international trade logistics in the country that needs a lot of review reform, infrastructure, systems and procedures, ICT functionalities. The concept of a single window, all the public or government agencies that are involved in regulating and administering international trade, a single window, which is happening in many countries. Those are concepts that we have proposed in the research paper as the way forward. And finally, of course, HR competency, which we could call the soft infrastructure. Right now, the Postgraduate Institute of Management is doing some courses. Katubadla is doing some undergraduate course on logistics, which is good. And there is a lot of other private sector agencies, training agencies that are involved in training individuals involved in these areas. So basically, this is what our findings were. And this is what we propose. And we request you, if you do get the time, please get a copy of the leaf paper that we have completed and have a look at it. So once again, thank you very much, the organizers. It's almost 8 o'clock here in Canberra, and time for me to say good night to you, but it's not night yet in Sri Lanka. So thank you very much, especially to the chair, Dr. Gunaruan. I know he's a busy person, and he just rushed from the university after his work. Thank you very much, and if I'm to answer any questions, I am ready, and my co-researcher Lalit is there present amongst you. Thank you very much for your time.